to answer questions about concentrators and concentrator repairs. Same time every week, 2 p.m. Central African time on Thursdays. Remember, you can always send questions to us by email at info@oxygenalliance.org, and we'll do our best to respond to them during the next Concentrator Talk session. If you have a question you would like to ask right now, you can also type it in the chat and we'll do our best to respond. So just a reminder that we'd like to ask everyone to keep their video turned off and microphones muted unless you're asking a question. Again, we're delighted to have several technicians with us on the call this week to answer your questions. We have Paulina Mohosho joining us from Johannesburg, South Africa. We have Kawinda Singh joining us from Chandigarh, India. And Mawi Lungu and Mteto Sinjani joining us from here in Lilongwe. So as usual, I'm going to read out the questions and ask one of our technicians to respond. We'll also paste the questions in the chat if you didn't get a chance to hear it fully. So let me start with the first question. So I have an AIRCEP Intensity 10 concentrator. From the service manual, I read that the pressure from the patient outlet is supposed to be around 137 kPa, which is roughly 20 pounds per square inch. And when I measured the pressure with a pressure gauge, it came to around 160 kPa or 23 psi. Though they do not advise to adjust the pressure regulator, I've tried to get it down to 137, and now I cannot get the pressure to settle at any point. It keeps fluctuating. How do I solve this problem? So Kawinda, would you mind answering this question for us?
Okay, sir. So in case of AIRCEP Intensity 10 concentrator, so the regulators normally used in all the oxygen concentrator, we can use a screwdriver to rotate clockwise to increase the pressure, and to decrease the pressure, we have to rotate it anti-clockwise. So in case of intensity, it is little different. So I can show this to you. So if you can see, this is that regulator. So on the top, it is written on the regulator, pull to adjust. So before adjusting, we can rotate it, not rotate it like this. We have to pull it like this. So like, yeah, now it is unlocked. So to increase the pressure, we have to rotate it clockwise, and to reduce the pressure anti-clockwise. So it can easily be done, and we have done so many times, never damaged. So maybe some during the changing, some diaphragm or something inside rubber or spring may have been not functioning properly. That can be the cause. So you have to replace this regulator only. So after doing the full process, we have to lock it. Then it will work properly. Correct?
Thank you so much, Kawinda. Any questions about this one before we move on? All right. So the next question we have, I have a Shenyang Canta concentrator, model number V8 WVNS with dual flow meters. Each flow meter has a maximum flow rate of 8 liters per minute. What is the recommendation of using this kind of concentrator? So I'd like to ask Mteto to respond to this question. Thanks.
Yes. So while not common, several manufacturers make concentrators with 2 flow meters. This allows one concentrator to simultaneously provide oxygen for 2 patients. So this model of concentrators is rated maximum flow of 8 liters per minute, but regardless of having both flow meters in use, the total combined flow rate from both flow meters cannot exceed 8 liters per minute. So for example, one flow meter can be set at 5 liters per minute, and the other one has to be set at 3 liters per minute. So you get a total of 8. So people mistake and set both flow meters at 8 liters per minute, making a total of 16 liters per minute. And this lowers the oxygen purity to around 50 to 60%. Yeah, so this is true to all concentrators that have dual flow meters. The performance is the same. So the Kanta concentrator, the J5 with dual flow meters, the performance is the same. The concentration or the purity goes down. Thank you.
Thanks, Mtsedo, for that. Any questions? All right, I think we can jump to the next question. I connected a Longfei J5 concentrator to the power one morning, and it was silent. No sound of the compressor, the fan was not spinning, and there was no LED lights coming from the control board. What could be the problem? Wawi, would you care to take that one?
Yes. So for most models of concentrators, they incorporate what we call a switching power supply design that is built onto the main control board. So for this one, it means that the voltage that you are getting from your wall socket is fed to the board at a full voltage. So whatever voltage you are getting from the sockets, either 220 volts or 115, depending on the supply from your power grid. So you get that supplied to the board. So for some design of oxygen concentrators, the valves are not designed to get the high voltage that gets supplied from the wall, like the 110 or 220 volts. So they incorporated a transformer on inside the concentrator to step down the voltage. So for this type of concentrator, the most common problem is the step down transformer. So in order to troubleshoot, just to be sure that it really is the transformer, the first thing that you need to do is you unplug your transformer from the PCB. So you are just removing the wires that are supplying you with a step down voltage. So as we can see from the image that is being projected, so we have a secondary side of the transformer. So that's the side that you need to check for. So the first thing that you need to do is to check if you are getting any continuity on the secondary side. So you set your ohm meter in continuity mode. And then when you hear a beeping sound, then that will tell you that your transformer is fine. And if you are not getting any beeping sound or the meter is showing open circuit, then something is definitely wrong with your transformer. So if the transformer is dead, then you need to replace it because it's not as straightforward to maintain the transformer. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for that, Mwawi. We have a question from the chat coming from Augustus. What is the function of the blowdown muffle in the Millennium Respironics concentrator? And how does one know if it is faulty? So Augustus, would you like to elaborate on your question a little bit? I think you're muted right now. If you can talk, you could just clarify a little bit more. In the meantime, our technicians are going to think about the question and see if we have an answer for this. All right, so let me put this to our technicians. The blowdown muffle, do we know what this is in the Millennium Respironics concentrator? I'm not familiar with this myself. Okay, I think as of now, we need to do more research on that. So we're going to come back to that question hopefully later on. And I think we'll jump ahead to the next question while we're thinking about this one. Okay, so I have refilled an AirSep 5-liter concentrator beds which were initially giving me 43% purity. The performance has improved, but I'm getting high fluctuations in purity between 89 and 74%. Any suggestions on how I can eliminate this problem? And I think we'll ask Kulwinda to respond to that one, please. And just a reminder for everybody, please do not turn your video on. We'd like video off and microphones muted unless you're talking. Thank you so much.
So while refilling the NEC beds, so there are some parts inside the C beds. So one is the ring. So we have to, before refilling, we have to check the proper shape of that ring, which is on the in the picture on the left-hand side. So that has to be properly. And other the plate and on some cotton-like product used on that plate, that should be proper. If I can show one here, so like this. So this is the part used on this plate like this, so that the sieve may not come out like this. So this is damaged, totally damaged. Right? We can see it. It is damaged. So we should not use like this. So otherwise we can use some cotton in place of this to cover this. So other are these rings. So these rings are to be in the proper shape. So in this case, the purity is fluctuating from 89 to 74. So it may be due to one seabed is filled properly and other may be having some leakage problems or not filled properly. Some moisture may be inside that. So that is the main issue in this. Na? So at the time of filling, we have to take care of these things. So that may be the problem, I think so.
Thank you so much, Kulwinda. Any questions on this? I think we know that the O-rings do get damaged, they get deformed, and changing the O-ring can significantly improve the performance. All right. I think moving on to the next question, we have
Jerry. Sorry, Jerry, you have a hand. Paulina, go ahead.
Thanks, Paulina. Yeah.
Okay. I would also like to add on to what Kulwinda was saying. So another important thing that I have noticed is that when you have underfilled the sieve beds, you will get a fluctuation. So you will need to check if you have filled your sieve beds at the correct level. And yes, that is also what I wanted to add. Also, overfilling could also cause that problem. And yes, and also proper filling techniques. If you have not used proper filling techniques, then your purity will fluctuate.
Do you want to just elaborate a little bit on the proper filling technique? I think I know where you're going with this, but I'll leave it for you to explain.
Okay, so when filling the zeolite onto the canister, you have to use a technique where you don't just pour the sieve beds, the zeolite into the canister. So if you do that, then the sieve beds might be overpacked or it might not be even inside of the canister. So what you can use is so this is what we use here in South Africa. We use the snowstorm filling technique. So what the technique does is it actually helps the zeolite to be, you have controlled, like you will have a slow and controlled filling into the canister, and the zeolite will pack evenly into the canister. So that will help in getting good quality purity once you are done refilling. I don't know if I can show you. Well, I've got it here ready, the canister. This is the tool that we have created using just PVC pipes and a funnel. So this is what we use. So we'll just put this into a canister and just pour it in, and it will go in evenly into the canister, and we get the purity of about 96% since using this technique.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Paulina, for those additional comments. All right, I think we can move on to the next question. We have 10 concentrators at our hospital. They are all the same model. We received a donation of an oxygen analyzer and we have tested them and they're all producing less than 80% purity. My two colleagues and I have basic troubleshooting skills, but we have never been trained on oxygen concentrators specifically. Can you give us advice on how to narrow down the problem on each concentrator? And I think we're going to ask Mteto to respond to this one. Thank you.
Yeah, so on this one, the two most likely components that would need maintenance are the compressor and the seat belts. So you are in a fortunate position of having all concentrators of the same model. So this means you can interchange parts between concentrators to help you determine where the problem might be. So for step one, the first and most simple test is to use a pressure gauge to measure the output pressure from the compressor. So if you don't have a pressure gauge, you can use one that is designed to test the pressure in vehicle tires. And I think you can see on the projection on your left side. Yeah, so to test the pressure, you must locate the hose that feeds compressed air to the four-way valve. The image on the middle is trying to show the position where you have the hose. That's the end hose from the compressor itself. So disconnect at the four-way valve and connect the pressure gauge there. So once you turn on the power, the compressor will run and the gauge will show the maximum pressure that it is capable of reaching. This will be an indication of how worn the caps and the sleeves are inside the compressor. So every compressor will be equipped with a pressure relief valve. So if the compressor is still strong, it will cause the pressure relief valve to activate and it can easily be heard. So you're gonna hear a sound like bzz, bzz, like a popping sound, yeah. So at this point, the pressure gauge should be showing at least 45 PSI or 310 kPa. So if the pressure is significantly lower or higher, this could indicate a possible failure of the pressure relief valve. So perform this test for all 10 compressors and note down the maximum pressure reached for each. This can be written on the compressor with a marker. So step two would be, like once you have performed this test, identify the concentrator that has the best performing compressor. And this can be used for the next stage of testing. From here, we move on to the seatbelt testing. So before removing the seatbelts from each of the concentrator, you need to label them so you know which concentrator they came from. So always keep them in pair. You don't want to mix them up. So next, you can install each pair of the seatbelts in the test concentrator, which has the strongest compressor, the one we identified earlier. So allow the concentrator to run for about 15 minutes or until the oxygen purity stabilizes. Using a permanent marker, write the purity level and the date of testing on each seatbelt. So remember to keep both ends of the seatbelt sealed when you are not using them to prevent moisture entering into the seatbelt. So after this process, we hope that you have identified a pair of seatbelts that are performing well. And in combination with the compressor you're using, you are achieving a purity of 90% or higher. So now using the same best compressor and the best seatbelts, you can test each of other concentrators to see if they are all performing well. With this approach, you can determine which seatbelt needs to be replaced and which compressor needs to be serviced. Additionally, you can likely assemble a few concentrators that can be put back into service by just interchanging parts or combining parts. This can be used while waiting for spare parts or to repair the remaining units. Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Mteto, for that long and detailed explanation. I know that we have colleagues from Zambia who have joined us this week. I think this question was motivated by them from discussions we had in December. If you guys are on and you would like to ask any follow-up questions on that, please, now's your chance.
Yes, Prince here from King.
Hi.
Hi, welcome. Everybody. Thank you. Yes, we wanted to find out if we're receiving low oxygen from the oxygen concentrate, which one can we check first, the sealed base or the compressed? And the second question is, what is the lifespan of the zeolite? And how can we tell that the zeolite is not okay?
All right, so we have two questions there. The first question was which should we check first, the compressor or the sieve beds? And then the second question was, what is the expected lifespan of the zeolite? I think maybe we'll pass the first question to Kulwenda, if that's okay. Kulwenda, what would you say in terms of checking compressor first versus sieve beds first?
Sir, in case of low purity problem, so there can be many reasons for that. No? So we here in India, we are testing the oxygen concentrator with the help of a pressure gauge, which is connected between the compressor and the four-way valve in the running condition, when the machine is in the running condition. So the pressure will go to a minimum level and to a maximum level, whatever the acceptance of that machine may be. So in our machines, it is from 12 to 22. So every time the seabed pressure starts, it will start from 12 and go to 22, correct? So it will be if it is in the same sequence for all the time, then the machine is working perfectly fine. Now, in case the pressure is going more above than 30 PSI, the pressure of the seabed of the machine from the compressor to the four-way valve, that is rising from more than 30 PSI, then we will say the seabeds are faulty. In case the pressure remains low, it may be going below 12 PSI, maybe 8, 7, something like that, and not reaching 22, maybe something 15, 16. So in that case, we will say the compressor is faulty. So that is the correct way of checking the machine in the
Thanks, Kulwenda. And I think the second question was, how do we know when the zeolite has reached its life expectancy, or how long can we expect zeolite to last? Mwawi, would you like to try and respond to that question?
Yes. So I think it just depends on the model of concentrator that you have. For the AirSip concentrator, they normally recommend that you change the zeolite once the concentrator clocks 20,000 running hours. So you need to change the zeolite after every 20,000 running hours. But then at OpenO2, we have discovered that this is not always the case, because we have had situations where we find a concentrator that is let's say around 2,000 running hours, but then it brings up low purity. So the first thing is, it just depends on the purity that you are getting. But then I think each model of concentrator has its own limits of after the period that you can change. But then, yeah, you can't really tell unless you check the purity.
Thanks, Mawi. I see a hand from Amarpreet.
Yeah, I just wanted to add on, there's really no such thing as knowing what the lifetime of zeolite would be. It's so impacted by the environment and the conditions that the concentrators are running in. So if you're looking for like, you know, here's a set of hours or a time when you should change the zeolite, it's actually more important that you perform a quick diagnostic, like Gulwinder explained, where you're looking at the pressures to determine whether the zeolite is, or you know, if the machine's purity is not at above 90%. Then you should start looking at the zeolite. But unfortunately, there isn't a guide that we can just use to say, after this many hours, zeolite should always be changed. The machine will tell you what to do.
And we've certainly heard stories from people working in the South Pacific Islands who claim that they have to change the zeolite every several hundred hours, which seems crazy, but in very, very high humidity environments, it seems that this can be the situation. Great. All right, so I see we've got some new people who've joined. I'd like to welcome you and just remind everyone that we can type questions into the chat. Also, please share your contact details in the chat so we can make sure that we have you on our email list. So I'd like to move on to the next question. I have a DeVilbiss 515 concentrator that has an issue with the rotary valve. Normally, I would expect the valve to rotate to a certain degree and then stop and then rotate again and stop whilst following a particular sequence. However, when I switch the concentrator on, the rotary valve rotates continuously without stopping. What could be the problem here and how could I resolve that? So Mteto, could you answer that question for us, please?
Yeah, sure. So as previously mentioned, the approach to removing nitrogen from room air that is used in an oxygen concentrator is known as pressure swing adsorption, others call it PSA. So to achieve this, valves are used to stir up compressed air and exhaust gases to and from the sieve beds during the pressure swing cycles. So the valves of concentrators mainly come in two configurations, either the rotary valve or the solenoid valve. But they all play the same role of directing compressed air to the sieve bed in a sequence for adsorption or purging. So older versions of DeVilbiss 515 have solenoid valves, and the newer ones of the 515 have rotary valves. So the rotary valve spins in a sequence with the help of the Hall effect sensor. So as you can see on the left side of the image, there's a more like a circuit board. Behind there's the sensor itself. So it uses, so when the rotary valve spins in the sequence itself, so it uses that Hall effect sensor outside, which is triggered by the magnet when it is spinning, as yeah, I would say so. So the problem here could be the Hall effect sensor. So before the sequence starts, the controller must get to the home position. The home position is determined by the small magnet, the one that is being pointed on the right side. So when it gets to that small magnet, the rotary valve starts its cycle. So if there's something wrong with the sensor itself, it's gonna keep rotating, missing the home position. So if you have this similar model, just borrow the sensor from the concentrator and try to learn it with the working sensor. If it works, then you just get a new one to replace.
Thanks, Mteto. And I can't remember if you mentioned it, but these rotary valves are found in DeVilbiss concentrators, particularly the 525 and certain models of the 515. And it seems like this is kind of like a proprietary design for DeVilbiss. All right, any questions? We'll move on. Okay, the next question. I was working on a DeVilbiss 515 that was bringing a need service alarm. I changed the sieve beds and serviced the compressor. The purity went up to 95.6%, but after running for approximately 7 minutes, the service alarm started beeping again. What could be the problem? Kulwinda, would you mind taking this question, please?
Yeah, please. So in this machine, they have changed the sieve beds, so they may be new one. At the other, they service the compressor. So while servicing the compressor, so I can show one thing. So today I have done the same thing. It was the same problem in Invacare machine. So these are the cups. So inside this, you can see the black version. So they are damaged. No? So from this side, maybe like this. So while changing this, we have to see the shape of this one. And other is the gasket, this one. So the machine was giving the same problem, right? It was working for 10-15 minutes and then giving the service alarm. Then we replace these both the parts. So when changing these parts, we have to see in that the size of this gasket must be in the proper size. Sometimes they are thicker ones, na? So if they are thicker ones, then the problem will come that the compressor will start heating up. So due to that heating of the compressor, that may be the problem, I think so. So otherwise, you can check the fan is working in the machine. That may be the problem, that I think so. Thank you.
Sorry, I lost my my mute button there for a second. Thanks, Kulwinda, for that one. So we have the next question. I have a concentrator that was working properly. The issue is when I connect it to an external splitter, which has five separate flow meters, the ball on the concentrator flow meter drops to 2 liters per minute. And when I adjust the flow on the concentrator, the ball does not go beyond 2 liters per minute. What could be the problem? Paulina, would you mind taking this one, please?
Okay, so when it comes to the oxygen splitter, so whatever setting that is on the splitter, that is what will reflect on the oxygen concentrator. So if your ball drops to 2 liters per minute, then it means that the splitter is then adjusted, is set to 2 liters per minute. So you would have to check the splitter, the setting on the splitter. So whatever setting that is on the splitter, that is what will reflect on your concentrator.
Great, thank you so much, Paulina. I think the next question we have here, sorry, just give me 1 second here. Okay, I am a biomedical engineering intern and was assigned to clean the inside of an AirSep 5-liter Elite concentrator. It was performing fine at the maximum flow rate, but now after just cleaning the inside of the concentrator cabinet, the ball in the flow meter is not exceeding 3 liters per minute. I'm not sure what I touched during the cleaning. Can anyone help? I think Molly, would you take this one? Sorry. Go ahead, Kulwinda, if you'd like to go ahead, that's fine.
So while servicing the oxygen control, maybe some that regulator may have been touched by somebody. No? So that can reduce the flow. So by adjusting from the regulator, we can see if it works up to 5 LPM or 10 LPM. Maybe the problem that may be. Or some leakage may be the problem.
All right. Any other input from our other technicians?
Yeah, so I think the other issue there would be the echo check valve. So the echo check valve is normally located on the exhaust port of the compressor. So it looks like a small gate valve, normally blue in color. most of the ones that I've come across are blue in color. So the echo check valve has two positions. So when you rotate it to one position, you limit the flow that you can get from there to 3 liters per minute. So when you change it to the second position, the maximum you can get is 5 liters. So depending on which position you flip that valve, that reflects on the flow meter as well. So it could be that when you are cleaning the concentrator, you bumped it from the 5 liter per minute position to the 3 liter per minute position. So that's why you are probably not going beyond the 3 liters per minute on the flow meter. Yeah.
What is the function of this eco valve? Why is it there?
It's there just to limit the flow, like the maximum flow that you can get from the concentrator. So it's normally found in the 5 liter models of concentrator. I haven't come across it in a 8 or 10 liter model. So if you don't want to exceed 3 liters per minute on your concentrator, then you switch it to the 3 liters per minute position.
All right, thank you. I see a hand from George. It was there, but now it's gone. Hello? Yeah, go ahead, George. You had a comment?
Just want to add what Mai is saying. Basically, you limit the performance of the compressor. So when you open fully to the echo check valve, the compressor performs for 5 liters per minute. But when, say, you need only 3 liters per minute, that's when you can turn that echo check valve to give you only that for 3 liters per minute. So basically, it's like you're not giving the compressor to perform at 5 liters per minute while you only need 3 liters per minute.
I'm trying to understand the eco component of this. Is it consuming less power when it's
in
eco mode?
Less power. Yeah. Less power, sure.
I see. Okay. Very good. Thank you for that comment. I don't see any other hands. I think we can move on to the next question. So I have a DeVilbiss 525, and each time I use it, it works well for about 15 or 20 minutes. And then after that, the low O2, the low oxygen light, turns on. If I turn it off and on again, the high light comes on, but after running again for another 15 or 20 minutes, the low light comes on again. What could be the problem? Paulina, would you like to take this question, please?
Okay, with this kind of problem, so with the DeVilbiss, the machine takes 20 minutes for the sensor to stabilize. And if you run the machine for 10 minutes, you will get the O2 high light on despite the level of oxygen it is producing. So if you get that kind of problem, then it means that there is a cause of the low purity inside of the machine. So you would need to follow procedures, the diagnostic procedures. So you would need to check if there are any leaks in the system. You would need to check if there are any kinks in the system. You would need to check your compressor. Maybe the seals could be worn. You would need to check also the valve of the machine. So you would basically have to do the diagnosis, find what the cause of the low purity is, and fix that problem. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Paulina. I think the last question we have for today, I have been working on a 515 concentrator for some time, and I've been able to service the compressor and change the zeolite without any issues. Recently, I came across a concentrator that had sealed sieve beds, and there was no obvious way to open them and refill the beds. Since I have the zeolite, I would prefer to refill them than to buy a whole new pair of sieve beds. Is there any way of opening and refilling these sieve beds? We'll ask Mwawi to respond to that one, please. Thank you.
Thank you. So sieve beds in the DeVilbiss 515 come in three different configurations. The first one is where the cup is held in place by a clip, and that is a clip that is placed on top of the sieve bed, and the clip goes into a groove that is made on the side of the bed, and it holds the clip in place, which keeps the top of the cup down, as we can see on the image on the left. So if you want to open the sieve bed, you just press the clip using a plier, and then you pull it out, and then the cup slides out nicely.
Is it the left? Is it the left or the right?
The right. The second one is similar to the first. It also has a clip, but then it has an issue. We had a hypothesis that maybe it could just be a factory fault or something. So when you remove the clip, you still can't get the cup to slide out because the diameter of the top of the sieve bed is slightly smaller than the size of the cup. So even if you remove the clip, you still can't get the cup to slide out. The third one is where you, the situation which you are faced with, where you have a sealed sieve bed. So for this one, there's no obvious way of opening the sieve bed. So for the first one, it's simple and straightforward. So for the second and third, what we did is we came up with a way of where we would just cut off the top of the sieve bed and remove the cup altogether. So as you can see on the image on the left, we came up with a device. So what we did here is we attached a grinder to a piece of plywood and screwed it down to a piece on the base. And then you have a place where you can slide your sieve bed in. And then we connected the sieve bed to a stepper motor. So the stepper motor is there to rotate the sieve bed at a certain pace, at a slow pace. So once you fit in your sieve bed, you turn on the stepper motor, it starts to rotate the bed, and then you drop down your metal grinder towards the sieve bed. So when you're using this method, make sure that you don't just drop the metal grinder all the way, because you want to be going in slowly by slowly. So you drop it down maybe by a millimeter or two, you let the stepper motor rotate the sieve bed, and then once it's finished rotating for the first time, you drop it down a little again, and then you repeat the whole process until the cup comes off. So when you remove the metal cup that you have on the sieve bed, it's a bit challenging to put back the same metal cup. You either need to weld it back on, which I think would be a bit problematic. So what we did was we came up with a design of a plastic cup. So we used the CAD software to design this cup, as you can see on the image to your right. So we fabricated that cup on the CNC machine. So the CNC machine has three axes on it. We have the X, Y, and the Z. So when you design your cup in the CAD software, you export a file that we call a G-code. So the G-code is basically a bunch of coordinates that tells the machine where to be at a particular point in time. So as it moves, it cuts out your cup. So after making the cup, we now go on to refilling the bed now, since we have a cup that we can use to close the sieve bed. So once you refill the sieve bed, we developed another device that helps us to easily refill the sieve beds. So the sieve bed has a spring inside of it that is there to helps to compress the zeolite. So it's a bit hard to do that by hand. So we developed this device. We just call it the sieve bed jig. So it has a big lever on top that helps you, that gives you an extra leverage to push down the spring. And then it has a small blue pipe. So the blue pipe is sits on top of the sieve bed, and that's what helps to push the cup downwards. So when you press the lever and you push the cup downwards, we just drill three holes on the side of the sieve bed that go all the way into the blue plastic cup that we made. And once you drill the holes, we screw in, we put in some small screws to hold the cup in place. Once you do this, there are times where you might get some leakages. Since this is just a modified cup, it's not what it was, it's not exact to the original. So we normally pressure test the sieve beds to around 40 psi, which is something close to what you would normally get from the compressor when the machine is working. So if you we connect it to a compressor and then we build the pressure up to 40 psi, and if you see that the pressure remains at a steady 40 psi, that tells you that you do not have any leakages on the sieve bed. But then if you can see the pressure slowly creeping down, then that tells you that you have some leakage on your sieve bed. So that means that you might have missed a step somewhere. So normally we just remove the screws and then just redo the whole process so that until we get a steady 40 psi without getting any leakages. So this is a method that we used, and it's so far worked well, pretty well for us, especially for the DeVilbiss 515 concentrator. So I think if you can try out this method, it's definitely going to work out for you. Thank you.
Thanks, Maui, for that detailed explanation. So I see we have a couple of questions in the chat coming from our colleagues in Zambia. I know that you dropped off at some point and you might have missed these explanations. So maybe what we can ask you to do is just to review the video in the interest of time. And if that doesn't help, we'll pick up those questions from next week. So again, I'd like to just remind everyone, you can post questions in the chat at any time. If you have questions right now, please post them. Also remind everybody to put your contact details and your location, what country you're in the chat, so we can keep track of who we're talking to. I think we have a couple of minutes remaining. I'd like to maybe just pass over to Amarpreet. Do you have any closing comments, Amarpreet?
Yes, I do. I would just like to take a quick second here and of course thank everyone for joining, and please, as Jerry just said, please put your emails in the chat. We will be sending out summary emails on the call as well as reminders for these weekly meetings that happen every Thursday at 2 p.m. Central African time. I also just want to take a quick minute and talk to you about the Auction Alliance. So we have launched our YouTube channel. We did that last week. If somebody can put that link in the chat, that would be great. And this is where we have all of the recordings of the Concentrator Talk every week that go into it. We will also have recordings of the different multimedia information that we create from the Concentrator Library. So this Concentrator Library is the second big initiative of the Auction Alliance. And just as a reminder, our goal here at the Auction Alliance is to improve access to medical grade oxygen in low resource settings. We focus here on concentrators and the maintenance side of that. So the more you can repair concentrators and get them working up to a medical standard, the cheaper it is as an intervention for that hospital system, government, or healthcare system to improve the access they have to oxygen. And as we all know, concentrators work nonstop. And that means that they don't need to be refilled like cylinders. And this is all what we're trying to do here by empowering you as members of the Alliance to quickly and easily solve any problems you have with concentrators. So do take a look at the Auction Alliance website. Tato, if you can put that link in the chat as well. And this is where you can see the material that we've created for the oxygen concentrator library. We also encourage any technicians in this group that are looking at potentially forming a company or working as a nonprofit to repair concentrators, and you're looking to either sign contracts or work with your governments, we encourage you to become members of the Alliance. There is a really nice intake form and some other information on the website for that as well. And then we can start promoting and highlighting you, and we can help support the efforts that you are putting in as well. So please share your emails with us, and we are really happy to see you all here, and we'll see you again next week. Thank you very much.
Great, and thanks from all the guys here in Lilongwe, and look forward to seeing everybody next week. Bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh.